Good morning, students. Namaste. Myself Seema. I'm faculty at the Equity Department, Jyoti Vidyapeeth University. So I'm taking the subject of human anatomy and physiology. Today we are going to discuss the topic of muscle contraction. So how the contraction at muscles take place. So basically we know we have cardiac muscles and then our skeletal muscles and smooth muscles. So this muscle contraction here, I'm explaining about the skeletal muscle mostly. Like what are the events, the process that take place inside a fiber of the muscle so that its property of contraction and relaxation take place. Muscle do have a property of contraction, become shortened, and then relaxation, become lengthened or coming to its original state. So this property, we are going to discuss that how this property has been achieved. How like muscles, what are the events, what are the chemical process, either at neurological level or chemical level take place so that this action take place inside a muscle or a muscle fiber. So there are few basic steps, few things, few changes that occurs within the muscles for the contraction to occur. So I'm going to enumerate all those steps and then we are going to discuss those steps. So muscle contraction event describing the sliding filament concept. So like inside a muscle, there is a concept of sliding the filament. So muscle has a structure of H zone, I zone, and then it has filaments. Those filaments, they slide to each other, then contraction take place. And then again, when they come to their normal place, then again they slide back, then there is a relaxation. So this sliding filament concept we are going to discuss here. So what are the events that take place in the sliding filament concept in this process? ATP, as you know, that ATP is like a powerhouse or it's like energy or coin, like energy coin for the cell, for the body, for any process to happen. So ATP binds to a myosin head, one of the filament inside a muscle, and forms ADP plus phosphate. So ATP has two things, ADP plus phosphate. So when the ATP it binds to the myosin head, it breaks down to form ADP plus phosphate. And when ATP binds to a myosin head, it's converted into ATP plus phosphate, one phosphate molecule, which remains attached to the myosin head. Then what the next step take place? Calcium, two molecules of calcium, calcium 2 plus, exposes the binding side on the actin filament. So there are two filaments, myosin filaments and actin filaments. So on the myosin head, ATP joins and forms the ADP plus phosphate molecule. Then on the actin filaments, CO2 exposes the binding side. Then Ca, calcium. The calcium binds to the troponin molecule, causing tropomyosin to expose the position on the actin filament for the attachment of the myosin head. So on the actin filament, due to the presence of the calcium, presence of two molecules of calcium, there is a position exposed for the myosin head to be attached. Next, what's the process take place? When attachment site on the actin are exposed, the myosin head binds to actin to form cross bridges. Okay, so there in myosin, ATP binds and energy released, and ADP and phosphate has been formed. Then at actin filament, Ca, calcium, two molecules of calcium comes and exposes the site for the attachment of the myosin head. So when this process has occurred, then this myosin head comes and attaches to the actin filament. So this sliding occurs. There is a cross bridge has been formed. Then the ADP and phosphate that has been formed before are released, and a sliding motion of actin results. The attachment of cross bridges between the myosin and actin causes the release of the ADP and phosphate, and in turn causes a change in the shape of the myosin head, which generates a sliding movement of the actin towards the center of the sacrometer. This pulls the two Z discs together effectively, contracting the muscle fiber to produce a power stroke. So the actin and myosin filaments attach, and this causes sliding coming together of the two Z disc, and this produces a power stroke, a power contraction. The ATP causes the cross bridge to unbind. So again, a new ATP comes when a new ATP molecule attaches to the myosin head before the ATP molecules attached, and then converts into ADP and plus phosphate molecule. Then again, after the contraction, after the power stroke movement, then again one new ATP molecule comes and attaches to the myosin head, and this ATP again unbind the cross bridge. Okay. Now the relaxation phase is there. The cross bridge between the actin and myosin breaks, returning the myosin head to its unattached position. So it will again go into the step one. Okay. So these are the events that take place for the contraction, the power stroke movement of the filaments, actin and myosin filaments inside a muscle, inside a single muscle cell, inside a single muscle fiber. Okay. Now, without the addition of a new ATP molecule, the cross bridge remains attached to the actin filament. This is why corpus becomes stiff with rigor mortis. Okay, because there is no movement of the blood, there is no gaseous exchange, so there is no new ATP molecules or no energy has been being made. So that's why it becomes stiff. The body becomes stiff. Now, stimulation of the muscle contraction, how this process has been stimulated. So as we know, stimulation is the part of the nervous system. Our nervous system plays a very crucial role for any kind of stimulation or function. So neuron or nerve cell are stimulated when the polarity against their plasma membrane changes. The polarity changes, called as action potential, travels along the neuron until it reaches the end of the neuron. A gap called a synapse or synaptic cleft separates the neurons from a muscle cell or another neuron. If a neuron stimulates a muscle, then the neuron is a motor neuron, and its specialized synapses is called neuromuscular junction. So since we are talking the contraction of the muscle fiber here, the nerve supply, the nerve cell which are giving the signal to the muscle to contract, there is a junction made between the ending of the nerve cell and the muscle. So that junction is called as a neuromuscular junction. Okay. Neuromuscular junction. The muscle contraction is stimulated through the following steps. So how this contraction, the process of actin myosin binding, the filament sliding curing take place, first signal comes from the neurons. So what are the events that occurs inside the neuron or at the neuromuscular junction? This is what we are going to see here. So action potential generates release of the acetylcholine. Whenever there is a signal from the brain or from the spinal cord level, there is a stimulation, action potential generation in the nerve cell. So at the end of the nerve end, where it has been attached to the muscle, there is a release of acetylcholine in the synapse, in the neuromuscular junction. When an action potential of the neuron reaches the neuromuscular junction, the neuron secretes the neurotransmitter acetylcholine, which diffuses across the synaptic cleft. The action potential is generated on the motor end plate and throughout the T-tubules. We have seen the T-tubules, part of a cell. The receptors on the motor end plate is highly folded region of the sarcolemma, initiate an action potential. So that acetylcholine which has been released in the cleft again generates the action potential in the sarcolemma, the layer of the muscle, the lamina of the muscle cell. The action potential travels along the sarcolemma throughout the transverse system of the tubules. The sarcoplasmic reticulum releases calcium, two molecules of calcium, as we know that we need the calcium for the actin filament binding sites to be exposed. as a result of action potential throughout the transverse system of the sarcoplasmic reticulum releases the calcium, two molecules of the calcium. Now again, a myosin process cross bridge forms, calcium released by the sarcoplasmic reticulums bind to troponin molecules on the actin helicase, promoting tropomyosin molecules to expose the binding site for the myosin cross bridge formation. If ATP is available, again we have seen that ATP is required so that it can be converted into ADP and phosphate, and energy has been released for the cross bridge formation. Muscle contraction begins. So this is the event that take place at the neuromuscular junction, and this is how the stimulation of the muscle contraction take place. Now the phases of muscle contraction. If we see the muscle contraction, whole process of the muscle contraction in phases. So what will be the phases? A muscle contraction in response to the single nerve action potential is called a twitch contraction. A myogram graph of muscle strength tension with time shows several phases. So what are the phases? First phase is latent phase, is that the time required for the release of the calcium. So the nerve stimulation, release of acetylcholine, and after the release of acetylcholine till the release of calcium, this phase is called as latent phase. Then again, contraction period represents the time during the actual muscle contraction take place. So binding of the calcium, then ATP, then cross bridging, the actin, the sliding filament theory. This whole process is called as, this whole period, the time take place for this time period, for this process to done, is called as contraction period. Now again, the relaxation period, as we have discussed that calcium will be removed from its sites, then ATP, new ATP will be there. So that period is called relaxation period, is the time during which calcium are returned to the sarcoplasmic reticulum by active transport. Now there is one more period, that is refractory period, is the time immediately following a stimulus. This is the time when a muscle is contracting and therefore it will not respond to a second stimulus. So during the phase of the contraction, there is a chances that nerves will have again like stimulus action potential. But since the muscle is already contracting, it will not contract again because it's in the process of contraction. So that period of time is called as refractory period. Since this is occurring at the same time of contraction, it does not appear on the myogram as a separate event. Okay, so phases of myogram. What is myogram? Myogram is the study, graphical study of the process of muscle contraction. Okay, so this here you can see the latent period, contraction period, relaxation period. Okay. Now the following factors contribute to the quality of the muscle contraction. If we will see quantity, quality, like what type of muscle contraction is there, like single contraction is there, or series of contraction is there. So if we will have to describe the quality of muscle contraction, how we have to describe. So there are few factors that contribute to the strength and maximum duration of a muscle contraction. So what are the factors? The frequency of the stimuli. Obviously, baat hai. It's like agar frequency jitni hai, us pe depend karega ki hamari contraction kaisi hogi. If stimuli are repetitively applied to a muscle fiber, CA may not be completely transported back into the sarcoplasmic reticulum before the next stimuli occurs. Depending upon the frequency of stimuli. वहां पे क्या कहते हैं, सी एक्यूमुलेट होने लग जाएगी, हमारी कैल्शियम एक्यूमुलेट होने जाएगी क्योंकि वो वापस नहीं आ पा रही, उसको टाइम नहीं मिल पा रहा, उसको रिलैक्सेशन फेज पूरा नहीं मिल पा रहा है. सो इन टर्न जो हमारी एक्स्ट्रा कैल्शियम जो है वो क्या कहते हैं वहां पे जमा होगी, तो वो पावर स्ट्रोक और ज्यादा कराएगी और स्ट्रॉन्गर मसल कॉन्ट्रैक्शन होगा. सो रिलैक्सेशन का टाइम ही नहीं मिल रहा वहां पे, सी ए जो हमारा कैल्शियम है वो एक्यूमुलेट हो रहा है, तो स्ट्रॉन्गर कॉन्ट्रैक्शन हम लोग को दिखेगा. ओके, सो इसकी वजह से कुछ इफेक्ट्स दिखते हैं. सो पहला इफेक्ट हमारा दिखता है स्टेयर केस इफेक्ट, जिसको हम ट्रिपी इफेक्ट भी बोलते हैं. ओके, इज प्रोड्यूस्ड इफ ईच सक्सेसिव स्टिमुलाई ऑकर्स आफ्टर द रिलैक्सेशन पीरियड ऑफ प्रीवियस स्टिमुलाई. इज सक्सेसिव मसल कॉन्ट्रेक्शन इज ग्रेटर देन द प्रीवियस वन अप टू सम मैक्सिमम लेवल. इन एडिशन टू द एक्यूमुलेशन ऑफ कैल्शियम, अदर फैक्टर्स सच एज इंक्रीज इन टेम्परेचर, चेंज इन पीएच ऑल्सो लेड टू दिस effect. Okay, like staircase, as the name suggests, each and every stroke, each and every contraction will be stronger than the previous one. As the stairs goes up, so this is what it is explained here. So wave or temporal summation occurs if consecutive stimuli are applied during the relaxation period of each preceding muscle contraction. Okay, so this is called as wave or temporal stimulation. Now the incomplete tetanus are also called unfused tetanus occurs when the frequency of stimuli increased, successive muscle contraction begin to blend, almost appearing as a single large contraction. Okay, so it's like stimulus are adding on to each other and the successive muscle contraction are again starting because of less time gap, blending to each other and appears as a large single contraction. Since the contractions are different, but due to lack of gap in the duration of the stimulus or lack in the duration of contraction, it appears as a single contraction. Okay. Now, complete tetanus, also called fused tetanus, occurs when the frequency of stimuli increases still further. In this case, individual muscle contraction completely fused to produce one large muscle contraction. Okay. Now, the strength of muscle. So, here, first factor we were seeing, frequency. Then again, strength of stimulus also. The more will be the strength, more will be the muscle contraction. It will intensify. Then the length of the muscle fiber contraction. So it's like because of a muscle fiber is attached to bone, muscle contraction is restricted to the length that are between 60% and 170% of the length that produces optimal strength. This range of muscle length limits myosin cross bridge and actin to position only where they overlap and thus can generate contraction. Now the type of contraction. Muscle contraction implies that movement occurs between myosin cross bridges and actin. However, this movement does not necessarily result in shortening of the muscle fiber. As a result, two kinds of muscle contraction are defined. Isotonic contraction and isometric contraction. Isotonic contraction occurs when the muscle changes length during a contraction, like shortening, and as a whole of a muscle, we are seeing there is shortening and there is length. Then isometric contraction occurs when there is no change in the length during the contraction, holding a bucket of water. Muscle is in contracted phase, you are just holding, there is no change in the muscle's bulk length. Okay, there is no change in the length of the muscle. Now again, the type of muscle fibers. If you will see that how the stimulus are affecting, how the muscle contraction are affecting. So again, type of fibers also affects the muscle contraction. Slow twist, so there are two types of fibers, muscle fibers, slow twist fibers and fast twist fibers. Okay, slow twist fibers contract slowly, have a high endurance, are red from their because of their rich blood supply. However, they do not produce much strength. These fibers are used for long distance running. Fast twitch fibers are rapid, fatigue rapidly, white because of less blood supply, limited blood supply, but they are of muscle of strength. Okay, these fibers are used for short distance running. Now, the next factor will be muscle tone. In any relaxed skeletal muscle, a small number of muscle contraction continuously occur, observed as firmness in the muscle. These contraction maintains the body posture and increases the muscle tightness. And now again, the next factor will be muscle fatigue. So muscle fiber stops contraction when inadequate ATP amounts of ATPs are available. Lack of oxygen, glycogen, the energy, the accumulation of lactic acid, byproduct of ATP production, together with the lack of ATP, all contribute to the muscle fatigue. So here we have discussed what is muscle contraction, how the muscle contraction occurs, what's the process and stimulation, and what are the factors that are responsible for the quality and quantity of the muscle contraction. Okay, so either the contraction is strong or slow because of this frequency, the fiber types, the tightness, the tone of the body, the tone of the muscle, the length of the fibers. So these are the factors that affects the quality and quantity of the muscle contraction. So hereby we are completing the contraction of the skeletal muscles, and do read this topic thoroughly. And I know you will have some confusion because a few of you are of not a bio background. So please read about it more. And if you have confusion, then ask me in our problem solving Google Meet class. And I will try my best to clear your confusions. Thank you. Do read this topic very clear. Okay. Thank you.